All right, we're going to take our Bibles this morning, and let's see, where are we here? 2 Timothy chapter 2. I want to talk to you about faithfulness, calling the faithful this morning. Mrs. Bramlett sends her regards. She's in a state in America called New Mexico, and it's about 40 degrees there. So she's enjoying being with her mother. Is June still in the hospital? Okay, so be praying for June. They're adjusting her medications and trying to help her with the pain. So be in prayer for June and her family. 2 Timothy chapter 2, with missions. It's based on the premise of faithfulness. I'm going to read just a few verses here in 2 Timothy chapter 2. Let's start with verse 1. Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men, who shall be able to teach others also. He really goes on then to the next subject when he says, thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier. There's some tremendous pictures here in 2 Timothy chapter 2 for us as Christians. And the first one is just to be faithful. You know, you appreciate faithfulness when you experience it from others. You know, knowing you can count on someone, counting on your parents, counting on your teacher. Thinking the other day how much we count on others when we're driving our car. You know, aren't you glad most of the time people don't swerve off onto your side of the road going the wrong way? You know, we're looking for people to be faithful so that life makes sense. It used to be there was a few odd people and we had what do we call that? They're eccentric or something. But a society can't exist if there's too many eccentric people. And it's kind of coming to that. Now, this is not part of my message this morning, but, you know, as Christians, God calls us to be faithful. Faithful is someone that you can rely on. And missions is accomplished by faithful people. And the Bible points out we have a problem with faithfulness. The psalmist said in Psalm 12, help, Lord, for the godly man ceaseth. The faithful fail from among the children of men. And so it was a problem back in David's time as well as today. It's hard to find faithful people. It's hard to be a faithful person. I mean, really. You talk to kids, and I was talking to somebody this week, and his mother was saying, oh, he doesn't like to study. It's boring. Mm-hmm. Now, boy, aren't you glad there's people who do the boring things so that we can exist, you know? Kids, when your parents get up and go to work, they don't do it because it's exciting. They don't do it because it's fun. They do it because it's faithful. And that's what God calls us to, is faithfulness. We expect our missionaries to be faithful. I mean, quite frankly, if they weren't, we wouldn't support them. You know, if we found out they were unfaithful people, we'd say, forget it. You know, get a job. 2 Timothy 2:2, the call for us is to be faithful people. The things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men, who shall be able to teach others also. See, when you're faithful, you're able to model and to speak the things of God. You know, God has had faithful people right through time. Moses, God makes an unusual statement about him. Just listen to these. It's Numbers chapter 12. God talks about how most people, he talked to them in dreams and things like that. But he said, my servant Moses is not so, who is faithful in all my house. He said, I talked to Moses face to face. Unusual man, Moses. A faithful man. Another one was a man named Daniel. The thing I find funny about this is his enemies wanted to destroy him, but you know, they couldn't find flaws in his character to pick on. In Daniel chapter 6, it said, they sought to find occasion against Daniel, but they could find none occasion nor fault for as much as he was faithful. They couldn't pick on the flaws in his character. You know, we've no problem doing that with our politicians and, you know, people today. Everybody's got flaws in their character, but Daniel was faithful. Neither was there any error or fault found in him. God describes Timothy as a faithful man. 1 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 17 says, "For this cause have I sent unto you Timotheus, who is my beloved son and faithful in the Lord." I can trust him to take the message to you. In Colossians, he talks about several different ones. Colossians 1, verse 7, he talks about Epaphras. I was thinking about some of these names. These are not real popular names anymore for people to name their children. Epaphras, haven't met any of those lately. Colossians 1, 7, he says, "You also learned of Epaphras, our dear fellow servant, who is for you a faithful minister of Christ." Aren't you glad there's people who are just faithful, just doing what needs to be done for the Lord? Later in the book, Colossians 4, 7, here's another name, Tychicus. Haven't met any of those either. He says, "All my state shall Tychicus declare unto you, who is a beloved brother and faithful minister and fellow servant in the Lord." These were faithful men. That's why we have the scripture today. That's why there's churches today, is because there was faithful people. I'd asked someone to sing, you know, "May the Lord find us faithful," as Alice sang today. You know, that's what we want for ourselves, is that when we're done, people say, "There's a faithful servant of the Lord." And there's people who can say, "My life is different because they were faithful." That's our goal. That's the goal of missions. And it's an amazing thing, as many of our most faithful, God takes them away and sends them somewhere else, you know? And they do that job, and they're faithful people who pass it on to others. And their goal is then to pass it on to those who pass it on to others. Someone said faith is like a ripple in a pond. You know, you throw a little rock in and the ripples go out. So that's the way faith is. You push it to me, I push it to them, they push it on. We want to be faithful people. In 1 Timothy, a couple pages back from where we started, Paul says this about himself. 1 Timothy 1, verse 12. "I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who hath enabled me, for that he counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry." You know, that's the way Christianity works. We don't put people into ministries to make them faithful. "Oh, maybe if we give them this job, maybe they'll come once in a while." No, we find faithful people and we trust them to do the work of the ministry. And Paul said, "What a blessing that God found me faithful enough that he'd give me an opportunity to serve him." And you know, folks, that's the key. It's a blessing to serve the Lord. It's not easy. Some places in the world, you'll give your life to serve the Lord. I mean, you'll die if you serve the Lord. But it's a blessing. It's a privilege to serve the Lord. And we should count it as such. We need faithful missionaries. We need faithful churches. We need faithful people. In 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 12, this is a real interesting verse about Timothy. Paul is writing and encouraging him, and he says, "Let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers." That's interesting, that word believers, it's the same word that Paul used to describe that the Lord counted him faithful. Faithful. Believers. "Be thou an example of the believers." And then he lists some things. In word, in conversation, that's manner of the way you live. In charity, in spirit, in faith, in purity. As Christians, we live in a dirty world now. But we need to keep pure. We need to be an example of the believers. God calls us to faithfulness. You know, I think this is really the bottom line. Aren't you glad Jesus is faithful? When we have to deal with our sin, we can go to him. And the Bible says if we confess our sin, he's faithful. Aren't you glad? Aren't you glad God doesn't have bad days? Or days when he's disgusted with you? "Oh, this Bill Bramlett, he's always asking me to forgive him for that." Just forget it. Not talking to you anymore. No, he's faithful. God is faithful and just to forgive us our sin and to cleanse us. I don't know. I was thinking about that fact this morning. I'm going to share an illustration with you, and you pardon me if it offends you, but we had an old fellow who came to a church I was pastoring named Gordon. He actually lived in a nursing home. He'd been with his family, but he just couldn't think anymore. And every time I took him home to the nursing home, he'd say, "What are we doing here?" "You live here, Gordon." "Oh, how long have I lived here?" Anyway, they changed his medication at the nursing home, and put it bluntly, he messed himself while he was at church. And I took him to the bathroom, and I cleaned him. You know, I thought, that's what God does for us every day. He cleanses us, and he's faithful. He's faithful to cleanse us, to forgive us. Aren't you glad God is faithful? And that's what God calls us to. God just calls us to be faithful. It doesn't have to be exciting. It doesn't have to be wonderful. It just needs to be right. In 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 24, he says, "Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it." Aren't you glad? Aren't you glad God's faithful? You know, when he makes a promise to you, he'll keep it. "I'll never leave you or forsake you." Man, you can count on that. You might feel like he's left you, but you believe what he said, and you know he hasn't. You don't go by feelings, you go by faith. In 2 Thessalonians 3 and verse 3, a similar statement, he says, "The Lord is faithful, who shall establish you and keep you from evil." And the point is this, he calls us to be like him. In fact, Jesus said exactly that in John chapter 13 and verse 15. John 13, 15, Jesus said, "I've given you an example that you should do as I've done to you." You know, we sing and we talk about being like Jesus. Well, that's what we're talking about, being faithful, just doing our best for the Lord. There's a verse in Romans 8. We're normally quite familiar with it. When he says, "For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son." It's just saying, God's never surprised by anything. He knows whether you're going to get saved or not. And if you're going to get saved, he's determined ahead of time, you're going to be like Jesus. Now, whether it's in this, you know, you'll start in this life, but he'll finish it in the next life, in eternity. "Whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son." Let me tell you, the process is a lot easier if you'll cooperate with him. I can remember when I don't know how old I was. I must have been 5, maybe 6. And I decided that this Sunday I wasn't going to church. And so I hid under my bed. You've never met my dad, but he was an interesting man. And, of course, in our home, you went to church. And he dragged me out from under that bed. And that was the roughest dressing I've ever had. He dressed me for church. Man, I felt like I'd been through a car wash. And off I went to church, you know. God has a purpose. Now, you can cooperate with him or not. But if you're saved, you're going to be like Jesus. You might as well be faithful. You know, what does it really mean in real life to be faithful? Well, it means basically that we can be relied on. Now, I know, we all know, none of us are perfect. We're going to fail. We're going to have shortcomings and so on. But it means that we can be relied on. Let me read you a couple of verses from Luke, verse 16. I won't read the whole passage, but Luke 16, verse 10. Again, these are all familiar portions. Luke 16, 10, he says, "He that is faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much. And he that is unjust in the least is unjust also in much. If therefore you've not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon." Now, unrighteous mammon is basically money or financial, physical things. "If therefore you've not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust the true riches? And if you've not been faithful in that which is another man's, who shall give you that which is your own?" See, he points out several things there about faithfulness. One is you need to be faithful with little things. If you're not faithful, listen, if I can't trust you with $5, I'm not going to give you $1 million. Yeah, we need to be faithful with little things. And he says you need to be faithful with money. In God's standard, money is not all that important except that you're faithful. He says, if he can't trust you with money, how can he trust you with true riches? I mean, the real things of eternity. And as well, he says, you need to be trustable with other people's things. Have you ever had that happen where you loan somebody something and they sell it? I had that happen once. Or they break it and bring it back and say, oops, sorry, it broke. Listen, be trustworthy with these kinds of things. And I just want to briefly this morning apply faithfulness to a couple of areas in regards to missions. Number one, we need to be faithful in our church. A local church is God's method of missions. Real missionaries, now unfortunately there's people who are called missionaries who aren't real missionaries, but anyway, real missionaries go and start churches. You know, they witness to people. When they get saved, they baptize them with the authority of the church that sent them and so on, and they organize them, and they get a church going. And then you know what they do? They send out missionaries. And they do the same thing. And we do it over and over and over again. But we've got to have people who are faithful. We have a guy who comes and... Anyway, there's a fellow I meet every once in a while. And every time I see him, he says this to me and annoys me every time he says it. Oh, I go to 3 or 4 different churches. And here's a person who's telling me, I'm not faithful. We need to be faithful. We need to have a church that's ours and that we function in and that we have a part of. That's God's method for missions. When Paul wrote to the church at Colossae, he said to the saints and faithful brethren in Christ, which are at Colossae. These were people who were members of that church. And you know, you'll find in the New Testament, every Christian was related to a church. And when they went to another and they said, you know, they'd send a note saying, receive this brother or this sister. You know, they've been faithful in our church and you receive them. Colossians chapter 4, verse 7. All my state shall Tychicus declare unto you, who is a beloved brother and a faithful minister and fellow servant in the Lord. You know, he sent notice. This is a faithful man. You can receive him. He'll be a blessing to you. Be faithful in your church. My goal for anyone who comes to our church is that you be faithful enough to have a ministry. You know, not everybody's going to lead the singing or teach a Sunday school class or something like that. But everybody can do something. Everybody can be missed if they're sick and gone, you know. You should have a function. Your pastor should be able to count on you. Like we read there in 2 Timothy 2 and verse 2. The things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men, who shall be able to teach others also. One of the things I notice is in the early church in Acts chapter 2, when people got saved, they were faithful. Now, I'm sure it was like now. There's probably, maybe they weren't all faithful, but he says that they that gladly received his word were baptized. Same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. They got saved, baptized, added to the church, and they continued steadfastly. And he lists some things. In the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, breaking of bread and prayers. Now, breaking of bread, and we can get a bigger crowd if we break bread, but listen, don't just be faithful when we break bread. You know, be faithful all the time. Faithful in your church. In a sense, when we send out our missionaries, it's like we're asking them to go over the cliff and we'll hold the rope. Listen, if you're holding the rope while I'm going over the cliff, you be faithful. You know, don't go do something else. Oh, oops. No, we've got to be faithful. As our missionaries go, we've got to be faithful at home. Like I said, we expect them to be faithful on the field. Let's be faithful at home. Secondly, we need to be faithful in our witness. I'll be preaching a message later in the month about how to kill foreign missions. Sorry to give away the punchline, but the basic way to kill foreign missions is to quit doing the job here at home. There's been Christian groups who've died out. You have done a great job, but then they die out because they quit doing the job at home. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, if you're in Timothy, it's just a couple pages to the left. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 6. This is a great testimony of this church in Thessalonica. He says, you became followers of us and of the Lord, having received the word in much affliction with joy of the Holy Ghost, so that ye were in samples to all that believe in Macedonia and Achaia. Macedonia and Achaia was their area. For from you sounded out the word of the Lord, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place, your faith to God's word is spread abroad. Yeah, here were people who were witnessing for the Lord to those around them, and it was going out. It was being sounded out. It's like Ezekiel said to Israel. He said, if you're the watchman and you see danger coming and you don't sound the alarm, man, God will hold you responsible. But if you see and you sound the alarm, that's what we're supposed to do. We're like watchmen on the wall, folks. We need to be faithful. People need to hear. Somebody told you. Who told you about the Lord? Aren't you glad they were faithful? Yeah, sometimes it was a parent. Sometimes it was a pastor. You know, some people get saved by a stranger, you know, just giving them a tract or talking to them. Somebody told you. Somebody was faithful. Aren't you glad? God said, ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. You know, our job, the basic job description is be witnesses. Faithful in your church. Don't decide every week, shall we go? Be faithful. Faithful in your witness. Be ready to give an answer of the hope that's in you. Know what God has done for you. And then thirdly, be faithful with your money. Now, the reason I mention this is a lot of our life centers around money. And if we're not faithful in that, if God doesn't have control of our finances, God doesn't have control of much of our life. You know, we spend a lot of time earning it, spending it, thinking about earning it and spending it, and so on. In Luke chapter 16 and verse 11, where I read earlier, it says, if therefore you've not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust the true riches? You see, the real riches are here in God and in eternity. You know, I think the problem that comes up is when we call it my money. If you're saved, listen, everything you have, everything you are belongs to God, and you're a steward. He says in Corinthians, it's required in stewards that a man be found faithful. We need to use it the way God wants us to. I heard of a pastor. He was a new pastor in town. I think it occurred in Scotland, if I remember. And as a new pastor in town, he had occasion to ride the bus. It was back in the old days where you actually gave him money and got change. Most of you probably don't remember that. Anyway, he got change. He sat down, and the guy had given him too much money. And so when he got off, he gave it back to him. He said, yeah, I'm the new pastor in town. The guy said, I knew that. So that's why I said, I gave you too much money on purpose. I wanted to see if you were honest. Man, we need to be faithful, don't we? Who knows who's watching? We need to be careful that we're honoring the Lord all the time. For the world to be reached for Christ, each one of us needs to be faithful. It's a tremendous job that God has given to us to reach the world. And I believe Acts 1:8 shows us that we do it as a church because he says, both. Ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and under the uttermost parts of the earth. You can't be both places at the same time, but as a church we can. That's God's plan, that we be faithful. Missions requires faithful people. There was a lady in Acts chapter 16, verse 15, that when she got saved, her name was Lydia, says when she was baptized in her household, she besought us, talked to the disciples, and said, if you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come into my house and abide there. Interesting statement, isn't it? She said, if you think I'm faithful, let me provide you a place to stay while you're here in Jerusalem. And it made me ask myself the question, am I faithful? And I would encourage you to ask yourself this morning. You know, ask the Lord, Lord, am I faithful? Like he said to Timothy, be an example of the believers. Are you an example of the believers? Are you a good example? We're all an example. Are you a good example of the believers? Like he said in 2 Timothy, are you able to teach others also? Are you a faithful person? Is the example of your life what a Christian should be? Are the words of your life, what you say and what you believe, are they an example of what a believer should be? Can we be what God wants? Well, we can by God's help. And you know, God promises to bless the faithful. There's a principle that God has. You're going to reap what you sow. We often make that just a negative. If you do bad, God's going to judge you. But you know what? The positive is true as well. If you do right, God's going to bless you. He says it over and over. Psalm 31, he says, "Oh, love the Lord, all ye his saints, for the Lord preserveth the faithful." In Proverbs 28, he says, "A faithful man shall abound with blessing." Yeah, another place says, "Give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down and running over." Yeah, God's going to bless you if you're faithful. There's a verse in Matthew I wanted to read. Matthew 25, verse 23. Matthew 25, verse 23, he says, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee a ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord." That's what we're talking about. God blessing us as we're faithful. Let me just encourage you to do this. If the Lord is speaking to your heart about this, if you're seeing some areas where you're not faithful, it's easily dealt with. Confess it as sin and start to be faithful. I mean, it's that simple, really. Just take it a bit at a time. God is very gracious and kind. And, you know, don't use excuses. You know, some people don't witness because they say, "I'm afraid." Well, everybody's afraid to witness. Come on, be realistic, you know? Just go past your fear and live by faith. Do what God calls you. Don't live by foolishness. You know, when we take the Faith Promise missions, if we have $1 million a week coming in, somebody's being foolish, all right? Unless they're rich people that I don't know about here. But anyway, we need to be faithful. And if we're not, confess it as sin and begin to do what's right. It's that simple. But you know, the key to faithfulness, it starts with your trusting the faithfulness of the Lord. It's realizing that God made you and God made a way for you to know Him. Like it says in John 1:12, "As many as received Him, to them gave He power to become the sons of God." It's His power. He gives the power to become a child of God, even to them that believe on His name. He'll help us. And it starts by trusting the Lord. Listen, God will be faithful no matter what. God will be faithful. He'll be faithful to judge sin. Listen, if you've never trusted Christ as your Savior, you mark it down. If you don't have Christ, you'll go to hell. God will be faithful. But you know, on the other hand, He says, "Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." God will be faithful. If you'll trust Christ, it doesn't matter your circumstance or your situation, He'll be faithful. And He'll save you. And He'll keep you. There's a reason He calls it eternal life. It's not just temporary. It's not something you can just try. Trust the Lord. Let me encourage you this morning. He's the example. He's our faithful God. You can be saved and know it today based on God's Word. We're going to take our songbooks and go to page 337. I think that's the right page. Trust and Obey. I thought that would be a good song to end with. Now, we don't want to use this song just as an excuse to quit thinking. What we're wanting to happen here is for you to respond to God's message this morning. Maybe you need to come and pray. Maybe you need to take some action in your Christian life. Maybe you need to follow the Lord in believer's baptism, or maybe you need to be saved. Well, today is the day of salvation.